We started December Dawn, one of the most difficult cantos of Savitri. In fact, if you want to really enter into Savitri for the first time, avoid December Dawn and go straight either to book 3 or book 4 and from that point onward. He has made it very difficult, at the same time very easy by writing and rewriting this canto any number of times. Maybe 25-30 drafts are there for this canto. So if you want to really begin Savitri for the first time, you start with something else and not with this canto. And I will say that was the mistake which was made by a university which wanted to introduce Sri Aurobindo's Savitri at the MA level, literature level. Voltaire, the Vice Chancellor was Srimad Sanyagar, and of course he was very enthusiastic to introduce Savitri into curriculum, and he started December Dawn. But then that also became the end of it, obviously. So don't start to begin with that, you see. But if you really want to still start Savitri with the December Dawn, start with a simpler narrative, not really simpler, but kind of more accessible to our imagination, the simpler narrative by the mother for the December Dawn. And that is what we are trying to do. We are first going through what the mother has said about the December Dawn. She has said many things which are not directly there in Savitri, and they give you a kind of an intuitive feel and a touch to what is there behind the text. And if you are able to grasp that thing, then you can kind of follow the text also more or less easily, you see. She started some of these narratives while Huta was doing painting with her. They had selected certain passages from Savitri, from the December Dawn, and then mother used to read those passages. Those passages are available in her own voice. This is what we played last time. The passages from the December Dawn read out by the mother. Those particular passages are the ones on which Huta had made the paintings first. So you have a visual picture, you have an audio picture, her own voice, and you have got the main text also. So actually, therefore, we need not really do Savitri December Dawn. You just go there and start. But still, we might do some foolish things and try to go through them and see what we can really grasp of it. So last time we had done a few sentences, up to sentence number 16 for the December Dawn from the mother's narrative. We'll continue that thing. Actually, we had done a little more than that, but I will to recapitulate the background, we'll start with this one. A thought was sown in the unsounded void. A sense was born within the darkness depths. A memory quivered in the heart of time, as if a soul long dead were moved to live. Very difficult passage. I mean, the English is very simple. There is not even one word which is difficult or complex that way. But the thought structure, the idea, the revelation, the force which is there behind it is something altogether different, not easily graspable by us at all. A thought was sown in the unsounded void. In fact, as I told you last time, we shall see these phrases in more detail as we go to our own narrative after completing the mother. Unsounded void, man, nothing was there. out of the separation of the four powers, you voided. It was not plumbed. Its depth was not plumbed. The plumbing of the depth of the void, that is what he is talking about. A thought was sown in that. Sense was born within the darkness of the, that is the beginning of things coming out of that void. A memory quivered in the heart of time, that is also the beginning of time. Memory quivered. Memory quiver of what was there before, what was happened before that. As if a soul long dead were moved to live. Now, of course, he says, as if a soul long dead, a soul is never dead. Soul is deathless, you see. But then this is as if. So you have to understand that thing. As if a soul long dead. That is way, one way of saying. At the same time, soul in English is also used in a kind of a general sense. Not necessarily the entity what we call soul, which is deathless. Angushta Matra Purusha, that is what we call by soul. It is not that which is always referred to by soul in English. In the English language, soul is also the soul of a nation, the soul of a plant, the soul of a creation or whatever. You see, it is sort of a more general thing also, you see. Although it is an entity as well. But here, so you have to understand the soul in two ways. Soul in the English language is a general term. And of course, there is the qualifying as if. If you take, as if a soul long dead were moved to live, the memory quivered, they came back, so it sprung up again into action. This is the memory of the origin. You see, I mean, they had gone away, those four powers had gone so far away from the origin that they had lost contact with the origin. They lost contact with the divine. They lost total connection. They were into the oblivion, as he says, thought also in the oblivion. So it is that as if got awakened again. That is the memory of the origin. So that memory is still carried. Then he describes the resistance. He, of course, the poet here, he describes the resistance. Yes, something is coming up, trying to be, but the oblivion that succeeds the fall. What it says, oblivion. See, now oblivion that succeeds the fall. You see, every word is kind of weighed perfectly. You have gone into the void, as you said here, into the unsounded void. That is the oblivion. It's the oblivion. Succeeds the fall. The fall. So he has already narrated in Savitri the story of the separation or the four powers from the divine source, the fall. They are coming from the divine origin. They have gone so far away from the origin that they lost contact with the origin. But still they carry some memory. So the oblivion that succeeds the fall had blotted the crowded tablets of the past. And all that was destroyed must be rebuilt. Well, some effort was made, something was brought into existence. It was again rebuilt and old experience labored out once more. So whatever was tried, whatever came into existence, that got blotted. But again, that must be tried and brought out. In front, all seems to have destroyed. This is what Mother says. You had done because your oblivion, it is the power of absorbing whatever comes out of it. You see, that's the power of death, power of the void. You see, it will not allow anything to exist. It is a total kind of a hunger, as the Upanishad says. It is a hunger, and it is that hunger which will swallow whatever tries to come out of it or comes into existence. It is only a seeming because it is latent behind the unconsciousness. All can be done if the God touch is there. So this is the most famous line, the aphoristic line, you see, all can be done. See, because can be removed, can be built, all can be done if that God touch is there. Now again here, that if is important. It is not that God touch will act in any kind of a circumstance. A certain background, certain preparation, certain readiness is also required for the God touch to get affected. God touch is there, therefore things will automatically happen. It doesn't happen that way. You have to be prepared. You have to have some kind of a readiness to receive the power of the God touch. Then only the God touch works. So all can be done if the God touch is there, and then the comforting assurance, all can be done if the God touch is there. So, in short, Shivendu is giving all the process of rebuilding the consciousness in the unconscious. Everything had become void, had become oblivion, and out of that now, out of this separation, you have to rebuild the entire creation. Life had become death, truth had become falsehood, bliss had become pain, all these powers which are there, they had to, consciousness had become inconscient. Out of that thing again, you have to rebuild. And all can be done if the God touch is there. But again, at the same time, certain kind of a preparation is required for the God touch to he caused the separation, the fall, as you said, no? Succeed the fall. When the four powers separated out from there, that is the fall. He calls the separation the fall. That is truly a fall of the consciousness into the unconscious. And now he describes how the message sent from the Supreme to repair the harm that weakens to gain the circumstance. As by kind of imperative influence to begin to climb up back to the Supreme Consciousness. He says harm. Supreme to repair the harm. The four powers went so far away from the origin that they became opposite. And it is that, so to say, mistake, that error, which had to be corrected. That is a harm. But perhaps that was not unanticipated. When you go away from the Supreme Source, you are bound to become opposite. Perhaps becoming opposite is also an aspect of the process, is a necessity. It has to be there. Otherwise, how can things come up? So, it is not really harm in that sense. Mother says harm in a general way, in a general manner, but it's not really harm. It is also a necessity that darkness comes out, that pain comes out, that death comes out, that inconscience comes out, because then out of that something can emerge. So it is that which has to be repaired in that sense. So this harm is an agent to promote an activity. And how he describes, and now he describes how the message sent from the Supreme repairs the harm done, wakens up again the consciousness as a kind of imperative influence. It has to work out to begin to climb up back to the Supreme Consciousness, begin to climb up. That is evolution. In other language, that is how the evolution will start, will begin, climb up, you see. So you see, I mean, she is narrating as a story, but the entire metaphysical content is present in the statement. This ascent is the, this ascent is the evolution that will take so many thousands and thousands of years. But for a very long time, it was not measured. Well, she is kind of not frightening us that will take millions and millions of years. She says thousands and thousands of years. Really speaking, out of a total nothing, the first appearance, out of the total nothing, the first appearance of matter itself, the dull, inner, dark matter itself, is a tremendous, tremendous, tremendous progress. See, something has appeared out of the void. So that is a major evolutionary step which has already occurred. Although we contain matter and all that kind of a thing, but matter is there now, and matter can withstand the swallowing force of the void. It does not get swallowed by the void anymore. It stands by itself. So that is the merit of matter also. That is the merit of matter also. So it has taken a very long time for that thing to happen. After matter came life, and now slowly mental being has arrived on the scene. So she is now really talking of thousands and thousands of years in terms of the arrival of the mental being. Before that, what happened? How long it has taken? Nobody knows. But for a very long time, it was not measured. It was not measured. Well, she says here, not measured. Who is going to measure? Mind. The arrival of man. The instrument for measurement is mind. So, obviously, when there is no mind, there is no question of measuring the durations of time and the sequence of operation, how things happen and all that kind of a thing. For a very long time, it was not measured. It was only when mind took the form in man, mental being in him, in mind. Mind is there latent in the animal, latent in matter also. But when it comes out prominently in the mental being, man, mind took the form in man, that time began to be measured. Time, mind is the measurer of things. Mind is the formateur, the best form. And before that, who can know how long it took to work out from the complete unconsciousness? He is speaking of the starting point of this evolution. So in this sentence is actually to be read in terms of evolution. And then he says, all can be done with the God that is there. As I told you last time, the G is a small G. You see, beautiful. Mother is giving 100% marks to Shivendu for this line. She is a teacher. She is putting in the notebook 100 out of 100. Beautiful, see. A hope stolen that hardly dared to be amid the night's forlorn indifference. So night where nothing can be seen, some kind of a hope is there because there is a possibility of the God touch operating here. And then he says, as if solicited in an alien world, with timid and hazardous instinctive grace, orphaned and driven out to seek a home, an errant marvel with no place to live, into a far off nook of heaven there came a slow, miraculous gesture, dim appeal. Now this is a very complex comparison. The simile itself is a very complex simile. We see it in more detail, but let me explain to you quickly what this means. See, the main sentence is this. Into a far off nook of heaven, there came a slow, miraculous, gesture, dim appeal. Well, that can be understood. In the background of what is happening, things are growing up slowly and waking up. And therefore, into a far off nook of heaven, there came a slow, miraculous, dim appeal. Yes, let us start, let us make move, that kind of a thing, stir, beginning, you see. So this is the main sense. But how it came, he is giving a comparison. The way the errant marvel tries to find out a place to live in an alien world, a marvel which has lost its way is trying to find out a home, a place to live in a foreign land, in an alien world. It is in that manner this miraculous gesture appeal is coming. Now, the sentence is like this. See, the main verb here is solicited first. And then the subject of this verb is errant marvel. So the sentence is an errant marvel solicited. That's all. The simplest language, the simplest grammatical construction is an errant marvel solicited. It is waiting, looking for something. It is trying to get some kind of a help. Marvel has lost its way. And it is soliciting some help to live, to go and be somewhere there. Where? It sought a place to live in an alien world. An errant marvel is seeking a place to live in an alien world. So it's a very complex grammatical construction, you see. Very powerful also, you see. An alien marvel with no place to live. Well, these are subsidiary clauses. An alien marvel with an alien marvel solicited. That's all. It is in that manner this appeal is seen here. Slow, miraculous gestures, dim appeal. It is looking for something. The way the marvel is looking for something. Alien marvel is looking for something. Mm-hmm. As if solicited in an alien. See how grammatically he has complicated the whole thing. You have to really pay great attention to the construction this way. That is the art of Savitri, the poetic art. It becomes very rich, it becomes very powerful also, very evocative. It becomes very evocative, you see. An alien marvel, an errant marvel is looking for something, what? For a place to live. Where? In an alien world. And while it is looking, it is soliciting some kind of a help. Please help me. So the way in which the errant marvel is looking, in that manner, this dim appeal. The prescient thrill of a transfiguring touch pursued it, the inert black quietude, again that black quietude, and beauty and wonder disturbed the fields of God. So that is the God touch. The persistent thrill of a transfiguring touch. We may remember that Shivendu puts together quietude, beauty, wonder. Beauty, wonder, quietude. They seem to be the beginning or the manifestation of the divine in the inconscient. That is a necessary condition for the manifestation to come out. Beauty, wonder, quietude. Quietude, prashant, beauty, saundarya, wonder, adbhuta. They had to be adbhuta, wonderful, you see. So all these things are there, present there, and they are the real beginning of things. In other words, it is as if Satchidananda himself is present there. And it is he who is trying to come out of that, you see. Beauty, wonder, quietude, you see. Quietude, you can kind of equate with Sat. Beauty, you can equate with Chit, consciousness, life, force. Wonder, with bliss, joy, happiness, you see. We may remember that Sri Aurobindo puts together quietude, beauty and wonder. They seem to be at the beginning of the manifestation of the divine in the inconscient. So really, who is coming out of the inconscience? Who is really coming out of the inconscience? It is Satchidananda himself who is trying to emerge out of inconscience. Out of the inconscience, it is Satchidananda himself who is trying to come out, you see. It started like that, quietude, beauty and wonder. Well, that is the basis of Satchidananda, you see. A wandering hand of pale enchanted light, that glowed along the failing moving spring, fixed with gold panel and the present hinge, a gate of dreams ajar on mystery's verbs. So the gate is now slowly opening out, should say. A wandering hand of pale enchanted light, because he is coming from far away like that, that glowed along a fading moment's brink, that is moment here, fixed with gold panel and opalescent hinge. Sometime later on we see some of these paintings also. One lucent corner, windowing hidden thing, forced the world's blind immensity to sight. So that coming, that appearance, it is really forcing you. The Sachidanand is trying to come out. It is forcing you to see things beyond now. For the world's blind immensity to sight, the darkness fell and slipped like a falling cloak from the reclining body of a god. So you can imagine a god wearing a robe, and the robe is slipping off from his body, you see. It is one of the most original images, similes anywhere in the literature. The darkness fell and slipped like a falling cloak from the reclining body of a god. He is replying, the robe is slipping out. So the darkness has just kind of disappeared by itself. Well, reclining body of a god, reclining body of a god. It is the inconscient Vishnu in the Patala, in the lost creation. He is asleep there, and as if his clothes are not slipping out, he is coming out from that. The inconscient Vishnu is waking up. Then to the pallid rift that seemed at first hardly enough for a trickle from the sun, outpoured the revelation and the flame. So that little opening was made, the gate was kept ajar, and to that window, to that opening, that little slit which is available now, outpoured the revelation and the flame. That is the awakening of the consciousness there itself directly, you see. Outpoured the revelation from above is coming down. The brief perpetual sign recurred above. And the mother says, it is the most poetic way of describing the waking of the consciousness to invisible thing. But why this waking up? What has created or given birth to this waking up? Shivananda says, the darkness fell and slipped like a falling cloak from the reclining body of God. A god has come down upon earth to wake it up to the inner consciousness. We could say that this was the first avatar. God has come down to wake up the consciousness. Now, of course, she says here first avatar in a slightly different way than what she also says when the horror of total separation was seen. The four powers had gone so far away from the origin that the Divine Mother was asked to plunge herself again into that thing, and that became the descent of the power of love in the inconscience. That love is the first avatar in that sense, you see, in the evolution sense. But here she says in terms of consciousness, you see, a god had come down upon earth. A god had come down upon earth, that is the avatarhood, to wake up the inner consciousness. We could say that this was the first avatar. It is coming down to the first avatar to wake up the earth to consciousness. That is to bring an intensity of consciousness and realization into the inconscient world. The revelation in the flame, outpoured the revelation in the flame. That is the first avatarhood. That is obviously the description or the appearance of the first avatar. It starts from that, because he puts then through the pallid rift that seemed at first hardly enough for a trickle from the sun, outpoured the revelation as a flame, the revelation as a flame, and a brief perpetual sign recurred above, the sign of the avatars coming, the double triangle. It is that which is blazing up in the sky, Shivendra's symbol. The brief perpetual sign recurred above. This is the sign of the avatar coming down upon the earth. A glamour from the unreached transcendences, iridescent to the glory of the unseen, iridescent to the glory of the unseen. You are not able to see the unseen, but still you are seeing the glory, you see. A glamour from the unreached transcendences, iridescent to the glory of the unseen. A message from the unknown invisible light, ablaze upon creation's quivering edge, dawn built her aura of magnificent hues, the colors of the morning, and buried the seeds of grandeur in the hours. That is the coming of the avatar, the dawn. Usha, Ritambhara, who is full of truth consciousness, an instant visitor, the Godhead shone. The Godhead is an instant visitor at the moment. On life's thin border, a while the vision stood, the vision, that Usha, that dawn, she's standing up on the border of life and bent over us, pondering forehead curve, interpreting the recondite beauty and bloom in colors, hieroglyphs of mystic sun, in words, the lines of a significant in telling of a greatness of spiritual dawn, a brilliant coat pen with sky for the page. The whole sky is there for writing a story, you see. That perhaps the sky also is not sufficient, it's not big enough for her to write the whole story, you see. This is a description of the first contact of the light from above, bringing an unknown message. A revelation and a flame, and then what is the message? An instant visitor, the Godhead shone on life's thin border, a while the vision stood and bent over us, pondering for it come. It is the answer of the divine to the condition into which had fallen the creation, and the first contact of the gods with matter. First contact of the gods with matter. The powers of light, interpreting the recondite beauty and flame in colors, hieroglyphs of mystic sun, it wrote the lines of a significant myth. That is the story of Savitri. Significant myth. It wrote, and for writing the story of Savitri, the whole sky is a big piece. Perhaps that sky is also not big enough to write her full story, you see. It wrote the lines of a significant man, telling of a greatness of spiritual dawn, greatness of spiritual dawn after dawn, a brilliant gold pen with the sky for pain. It gives the idea that the story of the world, of the creation, was told while it was going on, and it was inscribed to be kept forever. Well, the story is already written up there on the page of the sky. It has to be enacted here in the creation. The whole panorama is there, fully already described. The entire sequence is already described. It means that whatever happens is noted and kept in the memory of the earth. In the memory of the earth, it is the psychic being of the earth which preserves that memory. He says, it wrote the lines of a significant myth. That is the story of Savitri. The significant myth, the story of Savitri, he has managed to put in 24,000 lines. Perhaps even that does not complete the story yet, you see, 24,000 lines. That is the story of Savitri. It is at the time of first contact with the formation of the emanation from the divine with the atmosphere of the earth, that the story of Savitri was described. First time from the contact of atmosphere, and the story of Savitri described. Now this is important. She says, first contact with the emanation from the divine with the atmosphere of the earth. The story of Savitri begins with the arrival of man. Before that, first time the contact with the emanation from the divine. Almost that day, the epiphany was disclosed, of which our thoughts and hopes are signal flares, well, that is the World War image, Second World War, you see. A lonely splendor from the invisible goal, almost was flung on the opaque inane, again it's the opaque inane. We see this thing again in more detail as we go to the text one by one. Once more, a trait perturbed the vacant valve, infinity's center, a face of rapturous calm, parted eternal is that open heaven, a form from far beatitude seemed to near. So the arrival of the goddess, she's coming and approaching our sky, a form from far beatitude seemed to near. Ambassadress, she is the ambassadress now, twixt eternity and change, the omniscient goddess leaned across the breadths that wrapped the fated journey into the storm, and saw the spaces ready for her feet. She feels encouraged that now perhaps I can go and work here. Ambassadress, the omniscient goddess, the form. It is that vision which is standing out there. Now this omniscient goddess, he has not named her, obviously. She is the absolute power of manifestation. It is she who is coming here and doing the omniscient body. She is the creator of Satchidananda. And it is she who will come and do things further up here, you see. Ambassadors to eternity and chain leaned across the breadths that wrapped the fated journey into the storm, and saw the spaces ready for her feet. This ambassador goddess is important, omniscient goddess. It is the coming down of the mother, of the divine mother. She says, he says, and saw the spaces ready for her feet. Yes, perhaps I can go now and do something there. A lonely splendor from the invisible goal almost was flung on the opaque inane, from the invisible goal, beyond manifestation, it was Savitri coming down. So, who is Savitri after all? Savitri is the omniscient goddess. It is this omniscient goddess who is coming here as incarnate Savitri. It was Savitri is coming down. There is nothing to say. Nothing comes. It is all complete as it is. There is nothing to explain and nothing to add. This is what mother says. She has explained everything. What can I say in school that? Once half looked behind for a raised sun. Once she half looked, that goddess, she half looked, yes, let me see behind. Behind for her raised sun. Then, thoughtful, went to her immortal work, whatever work she is carrying on. Earth felt the imperishable passage closed. The waking ear of nature heard her steps. She is coming here, and the nature is now kind of awakened. Yes, she is arriving, she is arriving. And wideness turned to her its limitless eye, and scattered on sealed depths, her luminous smile, kindled to fire the silent world. It is smile that kindles fire. to silence the world. That is the power of smile, surir. All grew a consecration then arrived, kindled to fire. Divya Agni, bright fire is now kindled here, as if a kind of a yajna is going on, sacrifice is being performed here, and from that flame rises it. All grew a consecration then arrived, it is become a kind of a Vedic ritual now of kindling the fire and pouring ahutis into the fire. Kindle the fire, the silent the world. Air was a vibrant link between earth and heaven. Earth, Prithvi, heaven, Java, celestial god. Between these two, it is Vayu who is linking up things. Air was a vibrant link between earth and heaven. The vibrant hymn of a great priestly wind arose and filled upon the altar hill. So on those hills, they are now burning links. The high boughs spread in a revealing sky. So this is really the Vedic yajna which is going on here. Because she is coming here. In fact, if she is arising, she is coming here, appearing here, she will come out of this yogic fire, the fire of this yajna, she will emerge and stand there. That is how the birth of Savitri is described in Vyasa story. Ashwapati is offering ahutis day after day, month after month, year after year, for 18 years constantly. And at the end of 18 years, then from the yajna kunda rises the divine Savitri. It is that she is now here. The high boughs spread in a revealing sky. So the whole nature, everything is now engaged in that yajna, Savitri yajna. That is the expression how nature was conscious of her descent, because the descent was changing the attitude and nature of things. She came down to kindle the fire of aspiration. What is her purpose? To kindle the fire of aspiration, her coming here. Nature was conscious of her arrival. All that is considered as inanimate nature, that is the wind, the water, and the trees, the flower, everything received her joyously. It is only man who did not know, stupid fellow. You see, he does not know that thing. It is only man who did not know. Here, where our half-lit, that is man, half-lit, ignorance curled a gull on the dumb bosom to the ambiguous urn. Here, where one knows not even the step in front, and truth has her throne in the shadowy back of doubt, that is what we say. Is this true? Is it possible? That is what we keep on constantly asking ourselves, you see. And truth has throne on the shadowy back of doubt, on this anguish and precarious field of toil, outspread beneath some large indifferent game, impartial witness to her joy and bale. Our breasted soil bore the awakening ray. So it is the soil, the earth, which is really receiving the light of the Divine Mother. Here too, the vision and prophetic gleam lit into miracles, common, meaningless shame. Then the divine afflatus spent, withdrew, unwanted, wedding from the mortal's rage. She comes with the expectation that she will be received. She feels that everything is ready for her to come down. She comes down. All these things happen. Nature receives her, but this man is still not able to receive her. Therefore, unwanted, fading from the mortal's reign, she kind of goes back. Here too, the vision and prophetic claim, lit into miracles, common, meaningless shame. Then the divine afflatus, spent, withdrew. She wanted to come here, stay here, but find that things are not really proper enough, that she is not being received at all here. So she withdrew, unwanted wedding from the mortal's range. This is a big thing, unwanted. We don't want her, we are not ready. Such is our half-lit ignorance. As you said, half-lit ignorance, no? Now, of course, one can ask many questions, but we'll see in more detail. If she saw that things can happen and she feels that, let me go and do certain things, then what does she withdraw at all? What does she withdraw at all, you see? Unwanted, does she not know that things are not yet proper enough for her to be here? She makes an attempt, she tries to come here. Well, this pant withdrew. Withdrew is important. She is an omniscient goddess. Then how does she venture to come here and then go back without knowing all these things? If she has that all omniscience in her, you see, she has done kind of a miscalculation somewhere and felt that she might be acceptable here, that things might be ready here, but they are not. And therefore now she withdraws. So she seems to be a very typical kind of a lady, changing her mind quickly, you see. You see. And she withdraws. Why does she withdraw? Let me quickly say here, we'll go in more detail later on, but let me quickly say here. If things had to happen here in a deep and enduring manner, it is not that the coming of the omniscient goddess is going to help. God may come here, do work here, but that may not be of much consequence in the real sense. That may not be of real much consequence here. And she has to take care of something else for that purpose. Why it may not be of much consequence? A goddess coming and working is not the way of changing things. Cannot be the way of changing things. She has to come down here and take mortal birth herself and go through the entire process of the mortal to establish the divine light here in this creation. It is not by imposing light from above that things can happen here. Things have to be worked out from below, from within, that they are ready to receive the divine light, divine power, divine light, all those things, you see. So she has to go back. It is necessary as a goddess, she has to go back. We don't want goddess. She may do wonderful things. All these wonderful things might happen also, but they are not much consequence. Unless she undergoes through the cycle of a mortal birth, she cannot be really effective. She has to condescend to pass the portal of the birth, that is a death. Portal of the birth, that is a death. She must, then only her work becomes enduring, becomes something which can bring about a total transformative change. It is not by simply saying, okay, let me change. It's not that sort of a thing. So she has to go back. She knows it. She sees something has happened. Some kind of a preparation is made here. Now she is poising herself to come in the form of Savitri by taking a mortal birth. So then the divine apparatus withdrew. So there is a greater wisdom in withdrawing here, because she would like to come back now by taking the mortal birth as Savitri. You see. Then the divine apparatus withdrew, unwanted, wedding from the martyrs. See, by simply sitting up there or even being a god here and doing things, okay, death, you go away. It's not going to be working like that. You see, it is an occult fact that it is there and it has to be knocked off from below. So we have to take the mortal birth, and therefore she must come back now by taking the mortal birth. She will come as Savitri. She happened to say that a ray of knowledge, of light, of truth came down upon earth and was badly received, transformed into such a commonplace thing that it simply withdrew. Well, Mother is kind of generalizing it. This ray from above changed into a prophetic gleam, changed into miracle, even the most common meaningless shame. But then, finding no response, withdrew and wanted. No response means what? The kind of thing which she would like to do, for those things were not ready. Things are happening, but she wanted to tackle the basic problem of death. Mrityu is there, how to tackle that thing. So that is not happening. And therefore, she feels that perhaps another way has to be found for that by taking the mortal birth. It withdrew unwanted feeding. Many times it happened before it could come and stay. Well, Mother is giving you certain concrete examples now here. Well, actually in 1946, the mother of love, she was ready to come down here. She was almost here. But then she withdrew. When that happened, the mother of love, when she withdrew, she is not coming down at that point. Then a drastic strategy had to be worked out. And Sri Aurobindo decided that it can happen only by fixing the super mind in the physical and leaving his body, that she can be consoled. So her withdrawal was a kind of a hint of his withdrawing on 5th December 1950, you see. Without his withdrawal, things cannot happen. It had to be forced that way only, you see. She wanted to come down here, she is not. Again, same thing. Simply by coming here in that manner is not enough. You have to undergo through the mortal experience for doing certain things, you see. And therefore, she having to abandon his body. That's the mortal sacrifice. Many times it happened before it could come and stay. At least something like a response was needed to keep it. And it came many times, waking up the smallest thing. And then, not having sufficient response, it withdrew. Then, long periods of preparation, slow, dull preparation. Then, many times, an attempt to descend a ray, and things are lit up. And suddenly, they seem marvelous. But so many times, they fell back into their usual, formal, meaningless ways. Mother is narrating the history of evolution on Earth. How things happened earlier. But now, this time, there is a response. Something seems ready, and we shall witness the beginning of the change. So we have only to be attentive, to be awake, to look, and we shall see the beginning of the change. Something is beginning to change in the world, as Sri Aurobindo said. When it is like that, even the smallest thing becomes a living miracle, obviously. His sacred yearning lingered in his trace. She is withdrawing, but she is leaving something behind. A sacred yearning lingered in his trace. The worship of a presence and a power. Presence and a power. They go always together. Presence, the divine being. Power, the divine Shakti, they are always together, you see. Presence and the power, too perfect to be held by death-bound hearts. The patience of a marvelous birth to come. Patience of a marvelous birth to come. Now, he is already indicating that this divine goddess the omniscient Godhead, will come by taking this birth, this marvelous birth. She will reappear. She has withdrawn. She will come here. It is the prescience of her coming in the mortal form, taking the mortal world. Too perfect to be held by death without harm. The prescience of a marvelous birth to come. Only a little the God light can stay. Spiritual beauty illumining human sight. Lines with passions and mysteries, matters mal, and squanders eternity on a bit of time. As when a soul draws near the cell of birth, adjoining mortal time to timelessness, a spark of deity lost in matter script, its lustre vanishes in the inconscient flame, that transitory glow of magic fire, so now dissolved in bright accustomed air. He is giving again a simile how she is going back again. We'll see this in more detail later on, but let me quickly say, as when a soul draws near the sill of birth, when it's coming here, about to take birth, adjoining mortal time to timelessness, a spark of deity lost in matter script. So it comes here into matter and suddenly it feels lost, you see. Its lustre vanishes in the inconscient planes. It takes birth. The transitory glow of magic fire, so now it is all in bright accustomed air. It has gone back into its own accustomed air, you see. That is the explanation why the experience does not last. The atmosphere of the earth is too contrary to the magnificence of the supreme consciousness and weighs it almost constantly from time to time. It can show and express itself, but then again this inconscient atmosphere weighs it. It was like that when in 1956 the supramental power came down upon earth. Mother is narrating with another experience here of 1956. It was coming down in torrents of light, wonderful light and force and power, and from the earth big waves of deep blue inconscience came up and swallowed it up, you see. All the force that was coming down was swallowed up, and it is again from inside the inconscient that it had to work itself through. That is why things take so much time here. It is too much unconsciousness in the response that weighs what the earth is absorbed. Otherwise, it is long since the light had poured down and things ought to have changed. But we had to work with the hard stuff of here. The message, she came, she as an ambassador, she brought a message and she withdrew. The message sealed and weighed the messenger. He goes back, withdrew. The single call, the uncompanioned power, drew back into some far off secret world, the hue and marvel of the supernal beam. She looked no more on our mortality. How sad. The single call, that was the call of her vision. The excess of beauty, natural to God kind, yes, that is natural to her, God kind, excess of beauty, could not uphold its claim on time-born eyes. Too mystical for space-time, this space is too small for her to hold her, you see. Too mystical for space-time, see. Her body of glory was expunged from heaven. The reality and wonder lived no more. She goes back to see. She has gone back, and then what happens? There was a common light of early day. She has gone back here, and now we are again having the same daily routine here, chasing our bread and butter and our ambitions and our thoughts and our ideas and all that kind of a thing. Common light of earthly day. Now, this whole description, there was the common light of earthly day. This is an echo of Wordsworth's ode to immortality. He says, I saw the cataract speeding up and beauty and joy and all that kind of thing. But then after some time, I see that there is nothing there. It's all common, usual thing. Those daffodils are there, the flowers are not there, that lovely thing is not there. Now it's only a common, really routine, looking after the bread and butter and that kind of a thing. So this whole description is an echo of what Wordsworth has said in the Ode to Immortality, right in the beginning of that whole thing. We'll see that thing in more detail as we come to that line again. There was a common light of earthly day, absolutely that echoes. Shivan was a professor of poetry in Baroda. He knows everything by heart and he quotes everything. Affranchised from the response, from the respite of pity, once more that rumor of the speed of life pursued the cycles of her blinded quiz, of her blinded quiz, life. Her stands for life. All sprang to their undying daily acts. Well, this is what the routine we are doing, common light. The thousand people to the soil and tree obeyed the unforeseen instant's urge and leader here with uncertain mind. Alone, who stares at the future's covered face, man lifted up the burden of his fate. Man lifted up the burden of his pain. Obeyed unforeseen, unseen urge, and leader here with his uncertain mind. Uncertain mind, that is the quality of our leadership. Man, the mental being, he has an uncertain mind here. And it is he who is bearing up the burden of the whole thing, you see. Alone who stares at a few discovered grave. Man lifted up. Now, what it means, and then of course he says, well, let us read what Mother says. He is saying that the earth, the world is not yet ready to manifest the divine in its purity. And spontaneously, naturally, the divine gets veiled, hidden by the ordinary form. And even the difference of vibration is scarcely felt. Until now, in the creation, it is only man who looks at the future. All the rest of the creation is concerned only with the present. So that is the quality of man, something good. He looks at the future. The rest of the world looks only at the present. Man looks at the future and is anxious about it, but the future is veiled. The future's covered face, the next step in the evolution. We see the future. In other words, she is hinting that beyond man, now something which is better than man has to appear here. The next step is evolution here. Man lifted up the burden of his fate. But now, let us see quickly this part. And Savitri to overcome on these tribes that hastened to join the brilliant Samala's chant, and lured with the beauty of the apparent way, acclaimed the portion of ephemeral joy. And Savitri too awoke among these tribes that hastened to join the brilliant Samala's chant, and lured with the beauty of the apparent way, accustomed, lured with the beauty of the apparent way, acclaimed the portion of ephemeral joy. Savitri too awoke among these tribes. Among these tribes, man lifted the burden of his spirit, the mental being. So, Savitri's work begins with the arrival of the mental being on the evolutionary soul. Man has taken the burden on his head. At that point, she knows that he is incapable. Therefore, she takes the mortal birth. She awakes at that point. The arrival of the mental being is the beginning of, so to say, the life story of Savitri in his creation. Not that she is not there working earlier, but it begins consciously from the arrival of the mental being. And Savitri to awoke among these tribes, now he has proved plural. For that, you will have to go to what Shivendu has said in a record of yoga. about evolution. The races which were there before the coming of man, Vanaras, Pishachas, so many described here in great detail. We see that in more detail later on. But here described, there was the race of the Vanaras. Ready. The mental being were there. In fact, the avatarhood Rama is the beginning of the mental being. Avatarhood of Rama, you see. It is he who has brought Manomaya Purusha forward. And you can see the transition between the Vanaras and the divine beings coming afterwards, you see. So it is at that point of time that Savitri arrives on the scene, you see. So, in terms of evolution, there were in Greek mythology also you got giants and titans and the gods later on come to picture, you see. So giants and titans were there much before that. At that time, these were not. So Savitri's arrival here is at this particular point of the arrival of the mental being, those human tribes which are there, in which the mental being had arrived, it is at that point Savitri also steps into action. Man lifted up the burden. We'll see this in more detail as you go to the entire text of the record of Yuga about that. It's a very detailed account Shivendu has given in a record of Yuga. He is saying that the earth, the world is not ready, obviously, but it had to be prepared. No. See, even in the story of our avatarhood, you start with Matsya, fish, then tortoise, slowly Varaha. See, they are now getting ready, so to slowly, slowly, slowly. Vamana is also there, Parshuram is there. Then at that time, the avatarhood of Rama appears. And it is from that point onward, the evolutionary mental being comes forward more prominently. So the Savitri's, the work of Savitri begins with that particular thing at the time.